talk about this at transition all the time, that, you know, you don't want to reinvent the wheel. There's, you know, we talk about things we'd like to do, and then very quickly find out that it's already being done somewhere where we could help out with another group rather than trying to do it on our own. And, you know, rather than trying to do the same things over and over again to connect groups, but we do need ways of getting people connected. And there was a lot of talk in the election about using social media. Well, that's keeps coming up as a way for grassroots, low-budget groups to connect. Things like Facebook and just emails.
Parties for April 1st, 2009 to March 31st, 2010. That's the reporting period for any given report. Comes out in the fall. And we talk about important government decisions that are made, and we talk about applications, and I'll explain what these applications are that we get from groups like yours. And then I'll talk a little bit about some examples of, part of work is driven by what the government does, part of the work is driven by what the citizens apply for or use their rights to apply for, and part of the work is what we call developing issue, which are things that in the course of our duties with my staff and I find out things that maybe aren't being talked about, things that are important environmentally. So those sort of three elements combine and produce our report. But first, just to clarify, the first thing you've got to know about the Environment Commission's office is just to understand the role. It's very unique. It's very unusual. As Marianne said, there's only two environmental commissioners in the world that report directly to Parliament, myself and the one from New Zealand. But first, just to clarify, the first thing you've got to know about the Environment Commission's office is just to understand the role. It's very unique. It's very unusual. As Marianne said, there's only two environmental commissioners in the world that report directly to Parliament, myself and the one from New Zealand. And we're officers of the Legislative Assembly. I do not work for the government. I'm not an employee. I'm not the Ontario Public Service. I'm not a member of the Public Service. I don't work for Mr. McGinty, Premier McGinty. I work for the Legislative Assembly. My colleagues are the Ombudsman of Ontario, the Provincial Auditor General, they call them now, the Auditor General, the Information and Privacy Commission. There's a select group of people who report directly to the Parliament on the activities, that specialized activities of government. I oversee 14 government ministries, not just environment and natural resources, and, you know, the ones that are obvious, a whole range, health, labor, a whole range, 14 different government ministries that are involved in at least some of their activities that influence the decision-making, influence the environment. So, in that sense, that's an important concept. So when I criticize the government, I always tell it's not my job to criticize what the government's doing or not doing. And to a certain extent, so, you know, people always say, how can you say that? You know, he works for the Ministry of the Environment. No, I don't. I oversee the Ministry of the Environment, as well as 13 other ministries. So that's clear. So I usually describe my, pardon me, I often, you probably, those of you heard me speak before, you've heard this before, but nonetheless, there's a great book by Dr. Seuss called Lorax. I highly recommend it if you have kids or grandkids. And it captures the role of the environmental commissioner. There's a line that says, you know, I am the Lorax, I speak for the trees. I speak for the trees, so the trees have no tongues. And that's what the environmental commissioner does. My job is to speak for the trees. And also the brown barbuds, lay in the shade of the barbuds. But there has to be a voice in Queen's Park that, you know, we have political parties and they have agendas, political agendas nonetheless. We have bureaucrats and they have agendas for their various jobs. We have media people, we have business people, we have all sorts of lobbyists trying to influence things, but everybody has their own agenda. But my job is saying, I'm well paid to speak for the trees. They don't have to listen to me, but at least it is a voice who's talking about what's best for the environment. And we all know that governments have to make decisions from time to time that are not good for the environment. It's just necessary for the functioning of our society. But nonetheless, they should make those decisions with full knowledge of what's necessary for the environment. So that's the general concept. So the first thing that I talk about when I go through in the report, I look at all the significant environmental decisions made in the previous year. And I write them all up and make comments on them and assess them. And I just picked out four to quickly talk about today of things that happened in that year. Just a variety of kinds of things, just to give you a sense of what the Environment Commissioner is involved in, what people can be involved with. Now, I should say that most of these decisions, when the government makes a decision on new law and policy, they post it on the Environmental Bill of Rights Registry. And for some period of time, minimum 30 days, and people can comment under the Environment Bill. You can see comments. In some cases, you can even see committees to appeal for certain kinds of government decisions. So there is a role at decision making in the art to allow you to participate in those government decision making. At the end of the day, though, I look at those comments and I assess the things generally. So what are some of the things that we talked about? Well, the Servant Ecological Framework. What's a servant? Servant is a member of the deer family, and we have the government last year did this important new document. They looked at how all species of deer are managed, and we have in Ontario four species of deer family. We have the white-tailed deer, which you probably see around here, and we have moose. Most people know where those are, but then it gets a little thinner in terms of people's knowledge. The other two major species we have: caribou in the far north, and we have elk. Elk that were native and reintroduced. So the Servant Ecological Framework has quite a few pages of text where you analyze that quite a bit, because first of all, generally a good thing, because the government has finally stepped back for the first time and said, okay, we're going to manage all these deer, because these types of deer interact in various places. So down here, we're almost on the border where we have moose and white-tailed deer. And if you go further north, you get, there are some areas in the province where you get moose and white-tailed deer and caribou. And there is interaction between them, interaction with their predators. So they're starting to look at this managing on landscape, and there's it's generally a good thing. It's much better than the old system of managing just one species at a time and trying to figure out how many honey permits they should be allowed for and that sort of thing. So the interaction, for instance, the particular interaction between the caribou are a threatened species, woodland caribou, are a threatened species, and the interaction with moose is very, very important in that there's a dynamic of wolves and moose and caribou. Just jumping completely to something different. There was a decision made this year about sewage treatment and the parameters, how well we treat our sewage. Sewage treatment is an issue of the Lake Simcoe here. But just generally in Ontario, and for some years I've been asked to the Ministry of Environment on the sewage treatment standards, and they've been putting me off by saying, oh, well, we're discussing that as what's called CCME, that Canadian Council of Ministers of the Environment across the country. CCME had for, oh heck, 8 or 9 years been talking about new sewage treatment standards. So, and then they kept putting me off, but I'm asking the Ministry of Environment to say, okay, you know, we haven't updated these things in 30 years, and there's, we should have a look at this because they're maybe not adequate anymore. Well, finally, this past year, the CCME report came out, and the sewage treatment standards, now they treat, the standards are measured in BOD, that's oxygen demand in the water. BOD is a number in parts per million, and suspended salts, that's the particular matters left. And historically in Ontario, it's been 25, BOD 25, suspended salts, and one part per million of phosphorus is a sort of general standard. Well, after 9 years of consultation, they came up with a new standard for the country now, and it's 25, 25, 1. No, not even 1, that's right, they didn't put the phosphorus in the federal level. So there's been no improvement. There's been no change. So now, that's the basis of this report. You're right to say, well, we have many more millions of people. We have much greater loadings. It's very acute up here, like Simcoe, but even in the Great Lakes, it is very significant loadings. And come on, guys, maybe we should be looking at more rigorous standards. Maybe one's based on loading so much concentrations anymore, because we're putting millions and millions more people and more millions of more load, sewage load on the on our environment, largely on the Great Lakes. And it's just so my recommendation is let's look a little more rigorous here. So you can't hide behind these standards. We must do better than we did 30 years ago. Then jumping from something else, another decision was made. It was very unusual. Was relating to air quality. A couple years ago in Ontario, they redid the way they stand. This is the standards of air quality emissions. So if you're an emitter of some kind of air pollutants, there are certain numbers you have to meet for the different kinds of air pollutants, right? And a few years ago, they did what was the right thing to do. They said, okay, we're going to set new numbers. We're going to look at what's the very best number we want with respect to health and or environment, which in other words is more restrictive. So you can't emit more than this number for, you know, various kinds of, you know, the classic hypothetical pollution is methyl ethyl alcohol, right? Methyl ethyl alcohol, your number is 3, okay? You can't emit more than 3. And that's based on health and environment. Okay, but the reality is, for a lot of these pollutants, that there are certain situations in which the technology doesn't exist for a certain industry to get it done three. So how do we get that? Well, originally they said, well, we're going to have site-specific alternative standards. So if you're a company and you can't make three, maybe you can make four. You know, it's worse, but it's fair. It's all you can do. So you can go through a process where you have public meetings and we can maybe approve a four for you at a higher level. Of course, it was a very awkward process because, you know, it was kind of hard. This sounded good, it sounded reasonable because these companies really couldn't make those numbers. But can you imagine if you're, you know, the optics were sort of, you come into a room and you're the president of the company, you say, I want to emit more pollutants. I want your permission, Carl, to emit more pollutant than is safe environmentally and for health reasons. Sort of a hard sell in a typical crowd, I would think. So it wasn't working very well, granted, I've got to grant that. And so they came up with a new way of it and said, we're going to allow certain cases where there's more than one company that has this problem in a certain sector. We're going to allow a sector-based standard. And that means a sector-based standard. I'm not going to say it's going to be, so you can't make three? Well, as long as you put, well, on a sector-based standard, once we approve this, you can, as long as you put in this kind of pollution control, this, and do all these things, okay, that's your sector-based standard. You do that, and you'll meet, you'll be legal. But here's, well, I got some potential problem with that. Maybe there's a couple of issues around it, but here's the catch of the whole thing. If you're the company who can make three, just discharging three, you have to report your emissions every month to show that you made three. If you're the company that got special permission to go four, if you got through that process, then you have to submit your emissions every month for public, everybody sees them, to show that you're meeting the four. But if you got one of these sector-specific things, you don't have to tell the public what you're releasing. Now that's a little weird, and I wasn't very happy with that in my report. But that's the kind of thing that my policy officer would work at. I can see the quizzical look on your face. Yeah, no, it doesn't make sense, just in case you thought. You're sitting there saying, that doesn't make sense. No, it doesn't make sense. But there's some things. And of course, the other thing, another example, I'm not going to talk about a great length, is the decision that we're making was the Lake Simcoe Protection Fund, which is, remember we had the Act the year before. Well, the Act required there to be a plan, and the plan came out, and we reviewed the plan. The plan's quite detailed. It's not perfect. We're concerned about a few things, but generally, we're pretty happy that there is a plan. It reduces a lot of it's based on phosphorus and reducing the phosphorus load of Lake Simcoe. I don't know how close you follow that up here in Barrie, but certainly, you know, they determined that the safe level of phosphorus, if we can get the load of tons of phosphorus down to 44 tons a year, then Lake Simcoe can become very, very healthy and full of oxygen. The plan only over till 2045 only brings it down to about 58 tons a year. So it's a little bit, about 14 tons short, but it's down from 71 tons now. So it's better. So, you know, they're struggling, but it's generally a good plan trying to improve things. So does that give you a sense of the kind of decision making? So a variety of a bunch of other types of things. But it gives you a wide range of topics, all related to the environment. Something called an application for investigation. Or an application for review. Now, application for investigation is pretty straightforward, as much as you would anticipate just by from its name. If you have, you have to file like two citizens, two residents.